Beyond 100 metres, the ocean floor is nearly pitch black. At these depths, heightened senses are vital for survival. I've dropped cameras to the bottom of the Bali Sea before, in search of a species new to science, using bright white lights to illuminate the sea. But when creatures live their entire lives in darkness, I can't help but think the most secretive species are staying just out of sight, lurking in the shadows. So I built a night vision camera. Shallow tests produced great results, but can we replicate these results in the deep sea? Will the introduction of invisible infrared light encourage species no one has ever seen before to venture closer? And if so, could this change how we explore the deep ocean around the world? Down at 180 meters, the ocean floor appears barren, but with patience, the sand becomes alive. These squat lobsters, for example, are constantly moving around, searching for scraps that have fallen from the surface. Down here, where food is scarce, aggression is vital for survival, and by contracting their abdomens, vicious butt-first attacks are used to fend off rivals. Other inverts are also drawn in by the faint scent of carrion, including starfishes, urchins, and large venomous bristleworms. It's likely suspending the bait off the ocean floor causes some frustration, but much bigger predators also patrol the sand at these depths. This is a long-fin African conger eel. Whilst an interesting find, we've recorded these conger eels before, even under bright white light. They usually hunt at night, and this individual seemed a little confused as to why his nose had pulled him out of his daytime burrow. If you're new here, I've spent the last few years dropping cameras all around the Indo-Pacific. We've already recorded some fascinating species and new behaviours, but my goal is to take this project global, find new species, and pioneer a citizen science approach to exploring the deep ocean using novel camera equipment. Now, I know what you're thinking. Night vision during the day? Well, whilst testing this new technology, dropping the cameras during the day enables us to still see the faintest shadows of more secretive species drifting overhead, silhouetted against the brighter surface layers. And let's just say, there's some enormous creatures swimming around down there. But whilst on drop one we recorded some interesting species, we hadn't found anything new. Well, apart from this unicorn leather jacket that came into view on the way back up. We needed to do some testing.
Okay guys, so for those of you that watched our first attempt at underwater night vision, you'll remember that I talked about using different wavelengths of infrared. So today, we're trying out the 850s. The 850 LEDs are much less visible, so it's like a really faint red glow. The downside is the light will not travel as far underwater, so we might not see stuff quite as clearly, but fingers crossed. Other modifications to the rig, we've got some fresh new studs, so this will stop it skiing on the sand. And finally, we've got a new toy today that's gonna attach here and do some cool stuff, but we'll save that for later. Quick clue.
I'd waited months to get my hands on this 850 nanometer light. These LEDs are the perfect balance of invisibility and penetration, and as it descended, I was hopeful. But then, this happened.
Well, that is not good. The light flooded somehow. It's not supposed to look like that, in case you're wondering. Well, I guess we don't get to try out the 850s today then.
But after a quick cry on the beach, it was time to set up for drop three. And let's just say, our luck was about to change.
Ooh, and she goes.
Drop three was dominated by small predatory fish. Small breams hovered around the cage, picking away at small morsels flaking off. A lone sand perch also joined in on the action. With a flattened head and body, and with a name to match, sand perch don't usually spend a huge amount of time off the bottom. Although it appeared this one had found a new favourite perch to sit on. Other deep reef fish also drifted into view. I believe this is a species of hogfish, a group of fishes I've never recorded on these deep drops. Perhaps this was a sign that more cautious species are happier feeding under the red glow of the infrared lights. Maybe not. But whilst predators in the ocean sniff out food, many are also attracted to noise and movement, using their lateral lines to hone in on vibrations and pressure changes in the water that signal food. Perhaps we could take advantage of this sixth sense.
Okay guys, so we've got a new toy to play with today. No pun intended. This thing. Now, this can do many things, but what we're gonna use it for is to make this mackerel come alive. Hopefully this works. Let's give it a go. We stuff it in the mouth. Oh my. That's got to tempt a shark, surely. Look at it. It's even got multiple speeds. Anyway, the plan is we're going to hook this. The trouble is, once it's in, it doesn't stop. We're going to, hang on. No, come out. Oh, I think it's in now. Hook this bad boy on the front. We are in and we're buckled up. So the plan is just to have this fish swimming on the end of the bait cage like this, and hopefully something big's gonna come along and snaffle it up. That's the plan anyway.
And it turned out the plan worked. Well, kind of. Slightly shallower, the density of smaller reef fish seemed much higher. Either that or more fish were attracted to the moving bait. Whilst most were small, larger fish like this crimson jobfish came in for a closer look, as well as more unusual species like this brown-banded butterflyfish, a deep-water member of the butterflyfish family that isn't found in the shallows. Now, I have a theory that in areas that have been heavily fished, fish have either learned to be cautious, or the boldest individuals simply don't survive long enough to pass on their genes. As a result, many predatory fish like this large long-faced emperor that would normally attack first and ask questions later are suspicious, and for one reason or another decide that finding a whole mackerel on the ocean floor is probably too good to be true. On neighbouring islands, the fish do not share the same concern though. Let me know what you think in the comments and if you've noticed similar behaviour wherever you are in the world. That being said, there's one group of fishes that are still perfectly happy attacking anything they sniff out. The moray eels. This individual was perhaps a little too small to do much damage, although managed to find the soft part of the mackerel's belly and pull off a few scraps. Whilst morays are very common here, what appeared next was incredibly unexpected. This is a mola alexandrini, the ocean sunfish, and the biggest bony fish in the sea. It's assumed that these fish venture deep on the reefs of Indonesia in search of food, but recording one down at 130 meters serves as concrete proof. At certain times of the year, when the water cools, these ocean giants venture into the shallows to be cleaned by hordes of long-fin bannerfish that have a taste for mola parasites. However, these enormous fish eat zooplankton, primarily jellyfishes, salps, and siphonophores. It seemed pretty unlikely that this individual had been drawn in by the lifelike mackerel waggling away on top of the cage. The same cannot be said, though, for the next giant that drifted past in the blue. This is a pelagic thresher shark, famous for its incredibly long tail that it uses to whip and stun prey. Now, threshers don't scavenge, but instead feed on small schooling fish and squids swimming around in the blue. Given we've never recorded threshers in this area before, it's possible that the lifelike mackerel wiggling around on top of the cage made this one come in for a closer look. But whilst this may have been a coincidence, on the next drop we recorded two more. It could be the same individual, but threshers do move around together, following bait, so there's likely a population of them hunting down here. They're not the only big fish that came in for a closer look though. This is an enormous dog-toothed tuna. Like the threshers, tunas don't scavenge, but hunt on the move. Whilst we have recorded tunas on these drops before, this individual came by a few times. Perhaps the movement of the mackerel kept triggering its curiosity, or maybe the infrared light made it more confident. By this point, I was starting to realise just how much behaviour changes in the absence of bright white lights. Maybe I'd been scaring off half the ocean this whole time. Oh, and by the way, if you've got ideas for where we should drop these cameras next, or what tech we should try, drop a comment below. This project is just getting started. However, on fearful reefs, many predatory fish are more confident feeding under the cover of darkness, and as the sun started to set, I was curious to see what would emerge as the light began to fade, all the way down at 150 meters. And it turns out, the answer is some really weird stuff. Now, the predators here also seem to adopt a you-go-first approach to feeding. Nobody wants to be the first to test whether the lifelike mackerel flapping around on top of the large plastic tube is in fact free food, or a trap. Moray eels don't share the same concern though. They're the underwater guinea pigs, and they make sure to disarm their prey as quickly as possible. It's likely, given meals like this don't come around too often, that the eels feel the need to be incredibly aggressive, to ensure that whatever they've caught either doesn't escape or fight back. Balling up allows them to smother their prey and also create leverage to tear off large chunks of flesh. Perhaps the fact that this mackerel also moves made this eel even more energetic. But after a second eel came in and proved that the mackerel was in fact safe to eat, the confidence of other fish species, namely the crimson jobfishes, improved. With chemical and auditory stimuli peaking, the jobfish forget their fear and become bold and competitive, for if they don't feed, others will. Interestingly, it's difficult to say whether the movement of the mackerel increased the jobfish's aggression or made them more curious. Regardless, after the mackerel finally ran out of steam, the jobfish finished it off. Although at this point, the cage is still packed full of bait, and as the scent dispersed, other, much weirder deep sea creatures came in for a closer look. This is a silver toadfish, a member of the pufferfish family. Like other puffers, the silver toadfish's body is filled with tetrodotoxin, a powerful neurotoxin. Interestingly, this individual also seems to have a cloudy, damaged eye, and given these fish rely heavily on their eyesight whilst feeding, this puffer better hope its healthy eye doesn't suffer the same fate. Using a set of large fused teeth, pufferfish have no problem consuming a wide variety of sea creatures, like this small sponge-carrying crab. For these crabs, emerging from cover is risky, but they have a pretty neat trick. After making a run for it, this crab was nearly in the clear, but not quite. However, the crab doesn't carry around the sponge for decoration. It uses it as a shield. It's possible that this sponge is toxic, and as such leaves a nasty taste in the jobfish's mouth, although that doesn't stop them from trying multiple times. Luckily for this little crab, the large hyphen moray feeding on the cage was a little preoccupied. But whilst many predators are crepuscular, meaning they're most active at dawn and dusk, the really weird stuff is most active at night, where the infrared camera comes into its own.
Right team, so far we've done all the drops in the day, but the sun, hang on, is setting. Captain Made's got the Indonesian disco pumping. We've saved the smelliest tuna baits till last, and we've got the waggler. So fingers crossed for some good night action.
Right, we're in. Stop.
Now, the purpose of building this infrared camera is to test whether, by using invisible light, we can tempt more secretive species into coming closer. And it seemed, after watching the footage back from the first night drop, we were onto something. Although, unfortunately, the camera rig landed a little bit funny. At first, the rig was visited by small shrimps, clambering over the cage, rope, and even the camera lens. But other groups of crustaceans patrol the ocean floor here at night, including the isopods, woodlouse-like critters that have cleaned up the oceans for over 300 million years. Some of the biggest species can grow to over 30 centimeters in length. Many species of isopod are scavengers, feeding on carrion that drifts down to the ocean floor from above. Given the isopods we recorded on this drop eagerly squeezed through the small holes in the bait cage to feed on the tuna and mackerel inside, it's likely these are a scavenging species. Unfortunately, for some individuals that were a little rounder, the holes in the cage were slightly too small, although their efforts were commendable. Other species of isopod are parasitic, although that doesn't stop them from being preyed on. Or maybe it does. This is a species of deep water soldier fish, a predatory fish armed with large eyes that it uses for picking out prey in the darkness. Shallow water soldier fishes also have enormous eyes, and as such are often fearful of bright lights. It seems likely that this one was happier hunting close to the cage under the faint red glow of the infrared lights, alongside other new species. This appears to be a gadderfall, a species of cod, perhaps a large-toothed beardy. Some individuals that came in to feed were small, others were much larger. It appeared that the infrared light had worked, drawing in numerous new species, although after just one night drop, we'd only scratched the surface. If invisible light really can reveal these hidden species, imagine what we could find if we scaled this around the world. Although, one step at a time though, I guess the next obvious thing to do is to drop some more cameras at midnight. And let's just say, the strangest creatures come out to feed at night, including one creature that's perhaps never been seen here before. If you want to see what the infrared camera records at night here in Indonesia, make sure to hit that subscribe button. Oh, and I don't just drop cameras, I explore the oceans myself. So if you want to see what I find while scuba diving these reefs at night, you'll probably like this video.